Welcome to Speed Dating Tourism. Our first speaker this morning is Sebastian Mahfood, and he is Dr. Mahfood, and he is the dean of, is a dean? What do you call it?
Vice president,
of the interdisciplinary studies at Holy Apostles College and Seminary, and he is a very good friend of mine. He's also, this five years, he says, I have to mention this, this is the big thing. He is a very proud lay Dominican, and he keeps on trying to sell me on Dominican spirituality, and he's doing a pretty good job of it, because he's a darn good living example, and he's been very kind to me. He's a dear friend. His topic this morning is the relationship between natural and divine law, and Dante's Divine Comedy, and so here he is.
It's quite a build-up. I don't know if I'm worthy. As we say in Latin, non sum dignus. All right. So this is a talk on Dante, and it's hopefully a way in which we can use literature to demonstrate the truths of moderate realism. So the talk is entitled, who reads Italian in here? Is anybody, would anybody like to take a stab at this?
Images of a good point to Mackenzie Lester.
Oh, Fossa?
What are you?
Images of a good point to something false, which nothing redounding to the whole. How much
it is. But just read it in Italian.
Oh, okay, sorry. Much di divenz, seguendo fare, nemmeno promessione, regon di vera.
Oh, that's beautiful. All right, very good. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. All right. All right. The software I'm using on this is called Prezi, by the way. It's a free software. You can download it and just start using it. So there's me. Now, normally, I don't put my picture on my presentations if I'm physically there, but I wanted to make it easier for my future biographers. Sean's not laughing. He knows I'm speaking the truth here. But who knows? Anyway, the relationship between natural and divine law, what you were translating, is pursuing the false images of good that promise they never fully pay. Or to put it in Thomas Hardy parlance, that which was does not bear out in practice what was promised incipiently. So I've got 7 points only, and part of my my reserve here is to give some extra time for Sister's presentation, since it's going to surpass mine like the sun doth the moon. So the first 3 points are a story. It's Dante's lost in the dark wood, he meets Virgil, and he meets Beatrice. Now there's some 60-odd cantos that transpire between those two events, but I'm going to race through it. This is speed dating Thomism. Then I'm going to talk briefly about the nature of medieval philosophy, jump into natural and divine law, and then explain what Beatrice's reprimand to Dante means for us. Because she's not exactly warm and fuzzy when he meets her. You know, she's got a little bit of prickle on her in terms of letting him know what he did wrong. Now here's Dante. He's lost in the dark wood. So the question is, what is the dark wood? What is the dark wood of error? And so a lot of my students say, oh, well, he was pursuing all kinds of, material things. And, he had lust, he had pride, he had all of that. Well, sure. But there's something more that Beatrice's speech tells us. So Dante begins. I'm just going to pull directly from the text here. There's no reason for secondary sources. We can read the primary source. We're going to read it in English, make it easier on us. Midway in our life's journey, I went astray from the straight road and woke to find myself alone in a dark wood. How shall I say what wood that was? I never saw so drear, so rank, so arduous a wilderness. Its very memory gives a shape to fear. Some powerful imagery here. Death could scarce be more bitter than that place. Okay. Dante is every man. And as every man, he's trying to recount the experience of every man. He believed that humans have a common nature, that we're not like the angels, all sitting around with different natures, which is one of the hallmarks we might attribute to relativistic thinking. So Virgil shows up, and the thing that Virgil says is, I'm Virgil. And Dante says, glory and light of poets, now may that zeal and love's apprenticeship that I poured out on your heroic verses serve me well. For you are my true master and first author, the sole maker from whom I drew the breath of that sweet style whose measures have brought me honor. He's put a lot of faith in Virgil here. All right, and his sweet new style, the Dolce Stil Novo. He talks about it a few times, once in hell with Cavalcanti in the Sixth Circle Among the Heretics, again with Casella in the second canto of the Purgatorio, and another time with Bonaggiunta da Luca in the 24th canto of the Purgatorio. So the sweet new style is, just as a way of a footnote, an introspective exaltation of female beauty as a bridge to the divine. So Bonaggiunta says, you know, we just lack that one thing, we would have been as good as you. Now Dante all along, throughout the poem, has little hints about his own superiority. This is why on the second cornice, or ledge of purgatory, he reveals to Sapia that he's really worried about that ledge below, that ledge of pride, because he knows he's going to be spending some time there. So Virgil says, look, I've got to tell you a story, because Dante's not entirely certain he wants to walk through hell. But you know, he's already in a wood, a dark wood of error, that's worse than death. And so Virgil says, look, Beatrice came down to me, and she told me a story. She said, there's a lady in heaven, St. Mary. It's a very Mariological work, especially when you hit the Purgatorio, who saw you suffering down here in this dark wood of error, and she went to St. Lucia. St. Lucia, look at your boy. He's suffering. You should go and do something to help him. So Lucia, just like any good Catholic that would like to involve the entire community in the process of a salvation, goes to Beatrice and says, you know, you're our closest demographic. He really liked you on Earth. You go down and tell Virgil to bring him to me by Wednesday. Sure enough, you can do the math. He shows up around Wednesday in Canto 30. So Lucia says to Beatrice, Beatrice, true praise of God, why dost thou not help him who loved thee so? For thy sake he left the vulgar crowd. Dost thou not hear his cries? Canst thou not see the death he wrestles with beside that river? No ocean can surpass for rage and fury. It would be the river Acheron. He's close to hell, that he's also in the dark wood. Oh, let me go back here. This is what Beatrice looks like when she shows up. This is Canto 30 of the Purgatorio. She represents divine revelation and divine love. All right, so Dante's convinced that he needs to undertake this journey. He's not entirely certain what it means for him to do it, but he knows he has to understand and recognize sin, and he knows that he has to renounce sin. He has to turn his back away from the created thing, toward which he had earlier turned it, and back toward the Creator. The classical definition of sin is turning away from the Creator toward the created thing, so he's got to reverse that order. So when Beatrice shows up with a cloud of flowers that grows like fountains from the angel's hands and fell about the chariot in showers, a lady came in view, an olive crown, wreathed her immaculate veil, her cloak was green, the colors of live flame played on her gown. That's how she shows up, in all her glory. At least, in all the glory that Dante's able to see, without, like simile, bursting into flames and ashes. Because she can't show him her face yet. She can't show him her smile. Because Dante has to be prepared for these things. Even though he's just gone through purgatory, he's not yet completely prepared to see her, because there's one sin that he still needs to purge. So what is that sin? Dante says, "My soul, such years had passed since last it saw that lady and stood trembling in her presence, stupefied by the power of holy awe." Just read La Vita Nuova, you'll see what he means. "Now, by some power that shone from her above the reach and witness of my mortal eyes, felt the full mastery of enduring love." So, he's into this. However, he commits another error, and it's part and parcel of the first. He still hasn't gotten it. "The instant I was smitten by the force, which had already once transfixed my soul, before my boyhood years had run their course, I turned left with the same assured belief." Now notice he turns left. There's a symbolism in movement within this poem. "That makes a child run to its mother's arms when it is frightened or has come to grief. To say to Virgil, there is not within me one drop of blood unstirred. I recognize the tokens of the ancient flame. But he had taken his light from us. He had gone. Virgil had gone. Virgil, the gentle father to whom I gave my soul for its salvation." Now, does anybody notice after 64 cantos that Dante still hasn't gotten it? All right. Then he weeps, and she just lets him have it. This is the equivalent of saying, "Brother, you had it coming. Dante, do not weep yet, though Virgil goes. Do not weep yet, for soon another wound shall make you weep far hotter tears than those. Look at me well. I am she. I am Beatrice. How dared you make your way to this high mountain?" Now remember, she went down and asked Virgil to bring him up. "Did you not know that here man lives in bliss?" Now at this point, even the angelic choir thinks she's gone a little too far. Because, you know, he's sitting there trembling, you know, nervous, you know, probably worse than he had ever, you know, fallen down and swooned in front of her in life. The angelic choir pleads for Dante, and Beatrice explains to them, "I must speak with greater care, that he who weeps on that far bank," that's Dante, "may understand and feel a grief to match his guilt." So what's the grief? What did he do wrong? This man, potentially, she's not talking to Dante anymore, she's talking to the angel still, was so endowed from early youth that marvelous increase should have come forth from every good he sowed. But richest soil, the soonest, will grow wild with bad seed and neglect. For a while I stayed him with glimpses of my face, turning my mild and youthful eyes into his very soul. I let him see their shining, and I led him by the straight way, his face to the right goal. She's still alive at that point. But she dies. And everybody who understands, who's ever read Dante, knows the impact that her death had on him. Now, sure, he was married to Gemma Donati. They had four kids. But he never mentions her once in this entire Divine Comedy. This isn't about her. It's a poem about salvation. It's a poem about divine revelation at this particular point within the text, speaking directly to someone who does not yet get it. "The instant I had come upon the sill of my second age and crossed over and changed my life." Isn't that beautiful? We don't die. We just change our lives. "He left me and let others shape his will." Who are these others who are shaping his will? "When I rose from the flesh into the spirit, to greater beauty and to greater virtue, he found less pleasure in me and less merit." And again, she's speaking not just as Beatrice, but also as divine love and divine revelation. "He turned his steps aside from the true way, pursuing the false images of good that promise what they never wholly pay." What are those false images of the good? "Not all the inspiration I won by prayer and brought to him in dreams and meditations could call him back, so little did he care. He fell so far from every hope of bliss that every means of saving him had failed except to let him see the damned. So she brings him through hell so that he can come to heaven. And she'll be his guide in the Paradiso. For this, I visited the portals of the dead and poured my tears and prayers before that spirit. Now this is her side of the story. We've already heard it from Virgil. By whom his steps have up to now been led. The seal Almighty God's decree has placed on the rounds of his creation would be broken were he to come past Lethe and to taste the water that wipes out the guilty years without some scot of penitential tears. So she's got to put his face in what he did wrong before she'll let him forget about it. And you'll notice, well, I'll save that for a second. She doesn't let him forget about it. filled as you were with the desire, I taught you for that good beyond which nothing exists on earth to which man may aspire. What yawning moats or what stretched chain links lay across your path to force you to abandon all hope for pressing further on your way? What increase or allurement seemed to show in the brows of others that you walked before them as a lover walks below his lady's window? All right, at this point, Dante's got to say something. He's got to respond. And this is the only way he knows how. The things of the world's day, false pleasures and enticements, turned my steps as soon as you had ceased to light my way. He let her go, and he admits it. But what did he let go? Beatrice explains, nothing in art of nature or nature could call forth such joy from you. A sight of that fair body which clothed me once and now sifts back to earth. And if my dying turned that highest pleasure to very dust, what joy could still remain in mortal things for you to seek and treasure? The material world is ephemeral. Everything within it will pass, but one thing that won't pass is our eternal destinies. We just have to decide where we want to spend them. That's what he learned in hell and in purgatory. If to hear me grieves you, now raise your beard and let your eyes show you a greater cause for misery. So she's chastising him because he's not a young kid. He's old enough to know better. And so she gives him a vision of Christ in the form of a griffin. The griffins have two natures. Christ has two natures. I saw her turn her face to face that beast, which is one person in two natures without division. And there's the griffin. Now, Michael Mangini said something yesterday that was just incredibly profound, I thought. He said many things that were incredibly profound. Excuse me, I didn't mean to slide him in any way. It wasn't until Jesus appeared to Saul that he was able to organize all his interpretive ability. Suddenly, Dante gets it. And she persists. But why do your desired words fly so high above my power to follow their intent that I see less and less the more I try? They fly so high, she said, that you may know what school you followed and how far behind the truth I speak its feeble doctrines go. What's the school he followed? That of pagan philosophy. Ancient philosophy without the grace of divine revelation, without the light of divine revelation. And see that man's ways, even at his best, are far from God's as earth is from the heaven, whose swiftest wheel turns above all the rest. Now he swam across Lethe at this point. He says, I have no recollection of ever having been estranged from you. Conscience does not accuse me of defection. And she uses that as evidence with a smile. If, as you say, you lack that memory, then call to mind how you drank Lethe's waters here today. As certainly as smoke betrays the fire, this new forgetfulness of your wish to stray betrays the sinfulness of that desire. So I think of this anytime I'm ready to make an excuse to my wife. She says, well, you can't have just forgotten that. We talked about it earlier. I said, huh? But I assure you that I select the simplest words that need be from now on to make things clear to your dull intellect. I mean, she's already chastising. He swum across the river. He's forgotten. She has to bring it back up. Why? Why do they do that? Okay. So we're back. Here she is. In all her glory, well, in much of her glory, as much glory as Dante can stand without bursting in flame. So, here we get to the point. We're at the midpoint in our presentation, midway through our presentation's journey. And if you're lost, that's okay, because I'm about to clarify it all. In that statement, what she is pursuing is the need for divine revelation within our philosophy, within our understanding, within our work of the world, to bring those two things together. So the project of the medieval period was to undull our intellects. This is the value of scholasticism that one of our friends was chastising unduly yesterday, I think. But we each come to the truth at our own pace, and my prayers are with him. The medieval period is so called, after all, because it was that period in the middle, between the time in which philosophy was pursued as a habit of mind, unencumbered, if you will, by divine revelation, and the time in which philosophy was pursued as a body of content, seeking to disencumber itself from divine revelation. It's the medieval period. It's the age of scholasticism. We were applying faith and reason together. Scholasticism, as the application of a philosophical habit of mind to theological thought and study, was so relevant because it brought together faith, which is our active response to divine revelation, and reason, which is a discursive faculty. And from St. John Paul II. I like bringing in saints because it's hard to get up, argue against them too much. I've got saint in front of my name. Faith and reason, this is from Fides Ratio. Faith and reason are like two wings on which the human spirit rises to the contemplation of truth. And God has placed in the human heart a desire to know the truth, in a word, to know himself. So that, and you remember Gaudium et Spes, or Christ fully reveals mankind to himself. So that by knowing and loving God, men and women may also come to the fullness of truth about themselves. And this is, these are the words of Christ, which I'll get to in a moment, to love God with all your mind, heart, soul, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. So concerning natural reason, I'm pulling straight out of the Summa here. It is the light of natural reason, which is nothing else than an imprint on us of the divine light, whereby we discern what is good and what is evil, which is the function of the natural law. Natural law itself is nothing else than the rational creature's participation in the eternal law, and is promulgated by the very fact that God instilled it into man's mind so as to be known by him naturally. Now this is where the rubber hits the road, concerning faith. Faith, as an active response to divine revelation, involves our doing whatever he tells us. Adherence to divine law is just that, then, as Thomas explains. By the natural law, the eternal law is participated proportionately to the capacity of human nature. But to his supernatural end, man needs to be directed in yet a higher way. Hence the additional law given by God, whereby man shares more perfectly in the eternal law. I'm coming to my close. Hopefully I haven't taken up too much of Sister Margaret's bonus time. So there, look at the dark wood. What's Dante playing with? He's trying to fly with one wing. That's his issue. And if you look at the way the shadows are crept in the background, this came to me in a moment of inspiration. Ivano's got two wings here that he could don if he so chose. So So here's the takeaway, and then I'm done. Four short points. Faith and reason are the peanut butter and chocolate of the true way. Scholasticism is the only point in the history of philosophy that gave us a common sense approach to understanding who we are as human persons, endowed with both a natural and a supernatural end. That's a nod to Peter saying that Descartes was not a philosopher. The Aristotelian Thomistic synthesis was a common sense move toward a realistic understanding of our relationship with both God and man, providing us with a method to fulfill that otherwise cryptic but most important commandment of Jesus, to love God with all our heart, soul, strength, and mind, and to love our neighbors, ourselves. The capacity for the rational creature to participate in the eternal law of God, indeed the very capacity that enables joyful communion with our Creator, requires an active response to divine revelation, which we know as faith. Finally, Dante's encounter with Beatrice is a demonstration of how grace perfects nature, and how divine revelation and love carry to completion the work that man's rational nature begins in him. And so there you have it, all of that in one picture. They say a picture speaks a thousand words. That one did. Thank you very much.